Hello everyone, I am Dr. Ravi Ranjan from Atmi University. I am going to take one of the module of MSc Biotechnology program, that is Molecular Cell Biology. In this module, the first module which I am going to take is Signal Molecule. Let us study what is Signal Molecule. Before going to proceed with the Signal Molecule, let us try to understand how organism is responding to the environment. See, we all know that all organisms are responding to the environment. Say for example, when the day will be hot, you are feeling sweaty. You are feeling hot and sometimes sweats will be actually, you are feeling sweaty. Sometimes it may be happen that when you are coming in the cold condition, you feel relaxed. How it happens? It means we are responding to the heat. Like in the same way, when you do any type of behavior, you are responding to environment. These are the response of external environment. Like in the same way, our body is responding or our cell is responding intracellularly also. It means, see, we are multicellular organism. Multicellular organisms are made up of different complex networks, and all the cells are actually organized in such a way that they are communicating. It means one cell will communicate with the other cell. For communication of the cells, there are two things. One is neuronal communication, second is chemical communication. All this communication takes place through the signal molecule, and I am going to explain only those type of signal molecule which is present in the body, which is secreted by one cell, and this signal molecule will bind to other cell of the body. It means basically I am going to explain about the signaling molecule and the communication process within the multicellular organism. The communication occurs in unicellular also, but basically I am going to explain here about the multicellular organism. See, cell signaling is a basic process which must be needed by all the multicellular organism, because all the cells present in our body, they are communicating to balance the body. Different type of signal molecules are present here, and these signal molecules are produced by some type of cells and it is responded by some other type of cells. It means that there is a communication between one cell and another cell. Let's see about the signal molecule. These signal molecules are actually divided into several categories. Some of the categories you have already know about the endocrine signaling. Endocrine signaling or endocrine signal, both are same. Those type of signal molecule which are considered as hormones. It means they are ductless. These signal molecules are produced by certain type of cells, and these signal molecules are entered into bloodstream. Once it is entered into bloodstream, it means it enter into highway, and hence they are able to cross the barrier and they are able to pass from one location to other location. So they are also known as far distant signaling. Several type of hormones and chemical messengers you have already known. These all are endocrine signaling. Even in the plant, endocrine signaling occurs. In the plant, plant hormones are produced. I think you know, and in the previous classes, you have gone through several type of plant hormone like auxin, gibberellin, cytokinin, all these things. These all are signal molecule, and these are basically endocrine signals. Let's see the other type of signal molecule, that is paracrine signaling. As we know that endocrine signal molecules are traveling from one location to the other location in the far distant. Exactly at the same time, if we discuss about the paracrine signaling, this type of signal molecules are working in the close proximity. Close proximity, it means this is produced by one cell and they are working in the local area. It means it is stimulating other cell in the local area, which is present in the nearby cells, and they are responding. The best example is our synapse. It means, as you know, that one neuron and other neuron, they are very close proximity. How one neuron can connect to the other neuron? So one neuron is producing signal molecule. This signal molecule will stimulate other neurons, and hence between the neuron communication takes place. Like in the same way, neuromuscular junctions, I think you know very well, in the neuromuscular junctions, one neuronal molecules are produced or neurotransmitters are produced, and they will bind to the muscular junctions, it means muscle cell, the somatic muscles, and hence communication takes place. Third type of signal molecule are known as juxtacrine. The difference between this juxtacrine and paracrine is, juxtacrine molecules are actually contact dependent. It means any type of signaling in which one molecule and producers both are in the direct contact with the other cell, they are called juxtacrine. They are having a large application, especially in the autoimmunity or different type of immunity, say for example cytokines. Cytokines are also produced by extracellularly. It means cytokines may be juxtacrine, cytokines may be paracrine. But this is one of the best example of juxtacrine signal, because there are many cells which are directly come to contact, and hence further proliferation and differentiation occurs. The last type of signaling molecule is autocrine signal or autocrine signaling. Autocrine, they are very specialized. In autocrine signal, one signal molecule is produced by producers, and that signal molecule will return back and it will bind to the same cell. Say for example, there is a cell and cell will release signal molecule. They are not dependent on other signal molecule releasing cells. Those cells which release signal molecule, they are responding to the same signal molecule, that's why it is known as autocrine. So autocrine property is present in the cancer cells also, in which cancer cells are not dependent on other cells. They are producing their own hormones or own molecules. These molecules are produced and they are returned back and bind to the receptor of the same cell, and hence signaling occurs. They are present in many type of growth factor, prostaglandin and lipophilic molecules. So till that time, I just explained four type of signaling. Now try to understand what signal molecule are doing and what is the property of signal molecule. Signal molecule are basically messengers. They are passing messages from one cell to other. It means for the communication process, one cell should pass message to the other cell, and these other cells are responding. For response, there must be receptors. Say for example, I want to give you one coin, but how you will receive coin? You must have receptor, you must have hand to receive that. So signal molecule are produced by cell. It is a type of message which must be received by receptors, and now these receptors are responding accordingly as per the molecular natures are present or molecules are present. These signal molecules may be hydrophilic, these may be hydrophobic, and these may be gases. So let's see what is the difference between all these three. See, as per example, the signal molecules are hydrophilic. Hydrophilic means those type of molecules which are polar in nature. I'll explain later on what are the difference between hydrophilic, hydrophobic and gases. Let's see different type of hydrophilic molecules. Hydrophilic signal molecules may be amino acid, they may be peptide, they may be proteins, and they may be biogenic amines. The common point between all these three and fourth one, biogenic amines also, is they all have amino groups and they all are polar in nature, but still thyroid hormone is one of the exceptions which are not hydrophilic, they are hydrophobic molecules. Second type of signal molecule is gaseous molecule. Two very common type of gaseous molecule or gaseous signaling molecule is nitric oxide as well as carbon monoxide. The third type of signal molecule is hydrophobic. Hydrophobic may be steroids, they may be thyroxine, they may be retinoids. Overall, these three molecules, hydrophilic, gas and hydrophobic, they are categorized in such a way that hydrophilic molecules are able to bind to the cell surface receptor. The question is why? See, hydrophilic molecules are polar in nature, and if we'll see the nature of plasma membrane, it is made up of lipid and proteins. Proteins, whatever the protein channels are present, they are very very specific, and hence this hydrophilic signal molecules are not able to cross with this protein channels, and even they are not able to cross the lipids. So how this hydrophilic molecule will enter into the cell, and hence hydrophilic molecules are not able to enter in the cell. So what they are doing, they bind to the receptors which are present in this on the cell surface. So hydrophilic molecules are bind to the plasma membrane receptors only, and accordingly whatever the communication occurs, I will explain signal transduction process occurs and different type of biological responses occurs. The next molecule is gaseous molecule. Gas are able to diffuse, hence the receptors are present inside the cell, and like in the same way hydrophobic molecules are non-polar in nature, they are able to diffuse through the lipid layer, and hence they are directly enter into the cell. They are able to cross plasma membrane, and their receptors may be present in the cytoplasm, or they may be present on the nuclear membrane, or may be inside the nucleus. So their receptors are always intracellular. Let's see one by one. Steroid hormone. Steroid hormones, all steroid hormones and nuclear receptor family members. See, all steroid hormones are synthesized from cholesterol. Say for example, corticosteroids. As the name suggests, cortico, it means they are derived from adrenal gland, especially adrenal cortex. There are two famous corticosteroids. Basically, they are categorized as three, but two are the famous one. One is glucocorticoids, second is mineralocorticoids. Glucocorticoids are responsible for the production of glucose, whereas mineralocorticoids are basically regulating salt and water. So basically mineralocorticoids are acting on kidney, and hence they are able to regulate water and salt balance. Second category of steroid hormone is testosterone, estrogen and progesterone. They are the famous sex steroid which are produced by the gonads. Testosterone is basically male androgen hormone, whereas estrogen and progesterone, they are female one, but both are related to the sex steroids and they are produced by gonadal cells only. Third is ecdysone. Ecdysone is present in insects, so basically it is insect hormone that play very important role in the development by triggering the metamorphosis of larvae to adult. It means the conversion of larvae to the adult stage will take place by the interference of ecdysone, or you can say by the response of ecdysone molecule. Fourth is brassinosteroids. See, brassinosteroids, it's a hormone produced in the plant. So basically it is plant specific steroids hormone, and it is also responsible for the control of development, cell growth as well as differentiation process. Now next category is thyroid hormone. Thyroid hormone, as I already suggest in the back previous slides only, that thyroid hormone, though they are amine, but still they are categorized as steroids in nature, and hence these hormones are able to bind on the cell surface, they are able to enter into the cell, and their receptors will be present in the nucleus. So thyroid hormone are a very important hormone, which is basically responsible for the BMR, that is basic metabolic rate, and they are responsible for the regulations of the metabolism. Next come to the vitamin D3. Nowadays it is very important hormone. This vitamin D3, they regulate calcium metabolism as well as responsible for the bone growth. Now come to the retinoic acid and related hormone. They are considered as retinoids. They are synthesized from vitamin A, and they play very important role in the development of vertebrates. Now come to the next one. See, the important criteria of all these steroids hormone are, all these steroids hormone are hydrophobic in nature, and they belong to nuclear receptor superfamily. It means the receptors are present on nuclear membrane only. Next come to the gaseous hormone, nitric oxide as well as carbon monoxide. See, both of these, nitric as well as carbon monoxide, they are paracrine signaling molecules. It means they are acting in the close proximity. So these molecules are acting on nervous system, immune as well as circulatory system. Carbon monoxide and nitric oxide, they have very common feature. Both are neurotransmitter and both are mediator of blood vessel dilation. But still in our body, carbon monoxide is less popular because they have very very less role. But still, if you see the features of CO and NO, both are regulating cyclic GMP. It means they stimulate guanylate cyclase and responsible for the production of secondary messenger cyclic GMP. The synthesis of carbon monoxide in brain cell is stimulated by neurotransmitter. Let's see the detail of nitric oxide, because they are very important gaseous hormone. This nitric oxide is basically synthesized from amino acid arginine. They are extremely unstable and half-life is only few seconds, and hence they are not able to act for the longer time period. They are responsible for the nitrosylation of cysteine. Nitrosylation means NO group bind to a particular molecule, that is called nitrosyl or nitrosylation. So in the figure you can observe that this L-arginine is responsible to make nitric oxide, and this nitric oxide is produced in the endothelial cell and they enter into smooth muscle cell. In the smooth muscle cell, this nitric oxide is producing cyclic GMP, and this cyclic GMP are responsible for the relaxation. What is this relaxation? Try to understand here. It is basically related to the muscle relaxation as well as some other type of things related to the blood vessel dilation. Say for example, nitric oxide is responsible for the signaling of the dilation of the blood vessels that lead to the penile erection. It means erection of penis is related to the passing of the blood. So when penile erection occurs, it is directly related to the nitric oxide production. The next is nitroglycerin. Nitroglycerin is treatment of heart disease. It is a very famous treatment. It is based on the conversion of nitric oxide basically. It means some drugs are passed and they are responsible for the production of NO. This nitric oxide produced in the body and they dilate coronary blood vessels and increases blood flow. When blood flow will be increased, then on that time chances of heart attack and other problems related to heart is going to be solved. Then come to the next category, neurotransmitters. There are several neurotransmitters. Neurotransmitters means those type of molecule which are produced by one neuron and it will act on the other neuron. The famous examples of this neurotransmitter are dopamine, epinephrine, serotonin, glutamate, glycine and GABA. These all are neurotransmitter and these all are small hydrophilic molecules. Acetylcholine is one of the famous neurotransmitter. They are responsible for the connection of motor nerve as well as they are responsible for the connection of motor nerve to muscles. Histamine is another important neurotransmitter used in central nervous system. Adrenaline is again one of the important part. As you know, adrenaline is one of the very important hormone which is responsible for the flight and fright responses. When fear occurs, this adrenaline is responsible to the balance of the body. They are responsible for the sleep as well as alertness. Other hormones which are peptide in nature or proteins in nature, these all are categorized here. Insulin, glucagon, growth hormone, follicle stimulating hormone and prolactin. Insulin, as we all know, they are responsible for the decreased level of glucose. It means what they are doing, they are responsible for the glucose uptake. Glucose is converted into glycogen with the help of insulin. Glucagon is just reverse. They are responsible for the stimulation of glucose synthesis. Growth hormone is responsible for the stimulation of growth. Follicle stimulating hormone, which are produced in the male and female both, and in the female they are basically responsible for the growth of oocytes and ovarian follicle. In male also they are responsible for the spermatogenesis process. Prolactin, it is one of the important hormone responsible for the milk production in case of females. Then category of neuropeptides and neurohormones. In neuropeptides, several famous neuropeptides are present. Some of them are substance P, which is sensory synaptic transmission. The role is sensory synaptic transmission. Oxytocin is famous one. As you know, oxytocin is produced in the body during the parturation. They are also present in the less amount in our body, but during parturation the amount of oxytocin is increased and they are responsible for the stimulation of smooth muscle contraction, and hence the childbirth occurs during the parturation period. Vasopressin, another important hormone, they are responsible for the stimulation of water reabsorption in the body and they are acting on the kidney. Then two hormones, enkephalin and endorphin. These are two different hormones, or we can say neurohormones, but they are having same type of function. They are natural analgesic. As you know, all these analgesic are responsible for the decrease of pain. So pain response in case of central nervous system. Then next hormone is peptide hormones. In the peptide, there are several type of growth factor, interleukin and erythropoietins are present. Say for example, NGF, nerve growth factor, they are responsible for the differentiation and survival of neuron. EGF, epidermal growth factor, they are responsible for the proliferation of many type of cells. PDGF, platelet-derived growth factor, as the name suggests, it is platelet-derived. It means they are responsible for the blood clotting. So it is basically related to the proliferation of fibroblast in response to the clot. They are also related to the wound healing and regrowth of the damaged tissue. Interleukin-2, it is directly related to the proliferation of T lymphocyte, and erythropoietin is related to the development of RBC. So all these hormones are having some of the common feature that they are either related to the proliferation or it is related to the differentiation process. Next category is eicosanoids. The common feature of all eicosanoids are they are lipid in nature, and since they are lipid, they act by binding to the cell surface receptor. All eicosanoids are derived from arachidonic acid. It is a common feature of all, which is formed from phospholipid, prostaglandin, prostacyclin, thromboxane, and leukotriene. These are the four very famous examples of eicosanoids. These eicosanoids are rapidly broken down and therefore act locally in autocrine or paracrine signaling. They are also responsible for the blood platelet aggregation, inflammation, as well as smooth muscle contraction. Let's see the diagram. As I have already explained, phospholipids are responsible for the production of arachidonic acid. Arachidonic acid is converted into prostaglandin with the help of cyclooxygenase. Cyclooxygenase is an enzyme which is responsible for conversion of arachidonic acid to prostaglandin. Cyclooxygenase are of two types, COX-1, COX-2. It means cyclooxygenase 1 and 2. 1 is responsible for prostaglandin formation and 2 is responsible for the increased amount of prostaglandin formation. See, what is going to happen, if prostaglandin will be formed, they stimulate inflammation and they are also responsible for the cell proliferation and they promote cancer development. It means if anybody want to cure from the inflammation and they want treatment for the cancer development, what is the idea? The idea is prostaglandin production can be reduced. So what can be possible? If prostaglandin will be blocked, then all these things can be possible. There is a drug, common drug, aspirin. It is one of the famous drug. Aspirin is responsible to bind to the arachidonic acid and they are COX, and hence they are not able to convert arachidonic acid to prostaglandin. This aspirin can be given in the two different doses. If we are providing aspirin and some other drugs in the lower amount, then they bind to the COX-1 enzyme, and if it is given to in the higher amount, they bind to the COX-2. Finally, prostaglandin will not form, and hence it is able to reduce inflammation and pain. They are also able to reduce the frequency of colon cancers. Not only that, we will see the further details. This prostaglandin is responsible for the thromboxane as well as prostacyclin formation. They are related to the blood platelets aggregation and blood clotting. See, blood clotting can be prevented. In case of heart patient, as you know, that sometimes blood clot occurs in the blood vessels, and hence chances of heart attack is increased. So if aspirin is provided, this aspirin is basically responsible for the clot lysis. And if clot lysis occurs, prevention of strokes can be possible. And the last part is plant hormone. There are several type of known plant hormones are present. See, auxin. Auxin is responsible for the cell division and differentiation. Gibberellin is responsible for the stem elongation. Ethylene for fruit ripening. Cytokinins for cell division. And abscisic acid for the onset of dormancy. These are the different type of signaling molecules. They may be hydrophilic, they may be hydrophobic, or they may be gas, which I already explained. So these hormones are cumulatively affecting, and they are responsible for the transmission of messages from one cell to other. In the further lecture, I will explain how signal transduction occurs. Basically, these are the signal molecule which is considered as primary messenger. The complete signal transduction process can be observed in the further slides. For this video, I am going to stop here. Thank you.